to D20 Babes, episode 9. What was that?
Marital
Hiss. That's right. We are back. We are excited about tonight. I am going to just literally cut straight to the ladies so they can talk about the stuff they need to talk about, and then we will get as quickly as we can to the game. Thanks for being patient with us. I'm just going to switch it over here.
Thanks.
All right, go ahead, ladies.
All right. So I guess we need to start out with announcing who the winner is from last week. So I think the line from last week was...
I pointed my finger pointedly.
And the person who ended up saying that, we can announce now because we're not doing giveaways, unfortunately, at the moment. But it was Scott Skeener.
So that's S-K-E-N-E-R 47.
Yay! Yeah. So what you did was help Petunia out, and now she gets the trophy, so she can...
Again! And there was somebody commenting on our YouTube videos that we never... Even with this giant trophy in front of us, we always forget to use our advantage.
Oh, I know. It's been what?
Three episodes. I know. I just
put it right on top of your thing, no matter what.
They even said I had to move this trophy out of the way to use my
desk. I know. I read
that.
I was like, oh, it's
like,
true.
That's true. And in a time that I really could have used it. So, yeah. I don't know. We need to put something flashing, like flashing lights.
Use me.
Flashing lights. Okay.
Yeah. Were there any other things you guys want to do in Aspen Sport before we get started?
We have another little contest running this. So we have some awesome swag from an awesome people from Wizards of the Coast in support of our show. We just have to say thank you so much.
Thank you.
We're not wearing our shirts tonight because we actually haven't had a chance to sit down and like figure out what fits who, but we're going to be going bananas.
There will be fights.
You know what? Maybe we should film that. Us just going,
probably.
It's like Christmas. So there's something in there that it's a dice bag, Mind Flayer dice bag that we're all coveting just because it's so awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we figured to make it fair, we're going to have a duel to the death, which starts now. No,
please stop hitting the table, guys.
Okay.
contest.
So this is a little something that Curtis came up with. Maybe you want to explain what you're going to do?
Sure. Let me switch it back here. This is the only time I've used this me-only camera. I don't like it. All right, so there's going to be a secret word that if any of the ladies says it, chat, you're going to probably have to remind me because I forget about a lot of things that I promise. Too busy with the story. So if any of the ladies says this word, so this is kind of like a Pee-wee's Playhouse.
You can't look.
Did you see the word?
Yes.
You saw the word?
I'm so sorry. Well, now you can't win, and that's
it. Who leaves out this round?
Okay. I'm going to have to come up with another word.
Okay.
Okay, don't look at
it. And it's Julia sucks is what it is.
I'm so sorry.
This is going to perfectly describe my mood right now. That's the word now. And if anyone says that word, then they get to keep that dice pouch. So you guys can look back up.
Okay.
Now.
So are we all going to scream? Are you going to scream like if we say the word?
I will probably forget, so...
chat will tell.
I will keep an eye on chat, so chat, just remind us, and we'll go from there.
Ooh.
All right. I'm concerned about this frame rate drop. It's going to probably be all night, guys, so we're just going to roll with it. All right, so I think that's all the announcements. Let's just get straight to the story. So we left off last time with you guys getting on that sloop with the Justicars, I think they were called. Yeah, Justicars. And they whisked you away on the ship after you escaped Maven Vela, or now Minister Vela, after she basically demanded the bull from you, and a really brutal fight broke out, and you guys managed to escape with their help. There was some pretty brutal combat. A few people almost died once again, but you managed to get to the ship, and off you went. As you started to get the ship out of the bay, The large chain gate started to come down to block your escape out of the walled-in harbor, and you saw a flock of birds flying overhead, starting to dive down towards you. At this point, the captain, he starts turning and calling out to the crew, everyone in the on the ship who is actually working on it. A bunch of sailors are trying to get the masts up and trying to. They're already starting to do some rowing, but the captain doesn't think that they are going to make it, and he's calling out, "We gotta go! Our ship's gonna get cut in half!" And so they are moving. They don't really know what those birds are. They don't really understand what that's all about, but they're not paying attention to that. What do you do?
I actually didn't see the birds.
You didn't see them.
Who saw the birds?
I saw the birds.
So, all of us.
I was the only person that didn't see it.
Oh. You're the one that can shoot the mini arrows. I'm just going to say, speed the ship up. Go! There's birds. Lots of birds.
We're going as fast as we can. Can you help us?
What do you need?
I'm going to see if, Yeah, the Justicars they're obviously seeing those birds coming. Blythe, the wood elf monk, is telling, I guess, their leader, Whitford, about what's happened. She's trying to tell him as quickly as possible what happened with the raven / gnolls that attacked you guys. And, they are in full conversation, but they are distracted from what's actually happening. The four of you, two of you, they're not manacled anymore. So it's just the four of you are kind of in the corner right now, and there's no one really paying attention to what you guys are doing. What are you doing?
And the birds are coming at us?
They're starting to dive down. They're pretty high up in the sky right now, though, so you've got a bit of time. Not a lot.
Okay.
Leah, can you shoot them?
What?
Shoot the birds.
Shit.
I think there's too many. Is there too many, Leah?
Let me see what can I do in this situation? I think the best I could do would be the Rain of Thorns. If I can hit one of them with a cast, it sprouts from the bird itself, but I'm not sure if they would be able to dodge it.
I can cast Fog Cloud. Captain, do you know this water well enough that if I cast a fog, you can make it out?
Yes. Not a problem.
That way the birds can't find us.
That sounds like a great idea.
Yeah?
So okay. So the captain says, yeah, just give me the heads up, and maybe we shouldn't give her that.
You're
fired.
No coasters for you.
First you said look at the word, now you're making noises, honey. What do you do?
I'm on too much sweets.
Too much sugar. Should Leah shoot them first, and then you cast it?
You can do it at the same time?
Sure. Yeah, do it at the same time.
Okay. All right,
I have to hit one of them with an arrow, though.
Okay, you go first, and then I'll cast.
Okay. All right, which bow are you using?
I only have one with a string.
Oh, yeah, you did restring that. Okay, so you pulled that. All you know, it's called a hunter's bow. So you go ahead and you knock an arrow and you aim up. They're pretty high up in the air. What is the range on it? It's right now they're about 150 feet up in the air. You just see them swarming and kind of starting to dive down.
I think it was 100 feet for the longbow. Okay,
so it's at a disadvantage.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I cast my Rain of Thorns.
You're just aiming at one of the birds in general or the larger one? Remember, there's a larger one that...
Are they, like, around?
Well, actually, you didn't see that, so you don't know. You're just shooting at a swarm.
Okay.
So they're about 150 feet up in the air, and you just...
And they're, like, close, like, together, or...?
Yeah, they're swarming around in a circle. Yeah.
So it's a 25 to hit.
With a disadvantage?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Starting out good, so I'm going to stay that way. and then 1d8 piercing damage to whichever one I hit. Oh, I did one damage. And so Rain of Thorns, Hail of Thorns, if I hit them with a weapon attack, Rain of Thorns sprout from the ammo that hit them, in addition to the normal effect, target and each creature within 5 feet must make a dex saving throw, I think I cast the wrong thing, but that's okay. Takes 1d10 piercing on a failed save and half.
Yeah, which one were you wanting to cast?
I thought I had one that, and I can't seem to find it. in Snare Strike, the one that.
Is that what you wanted to do?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
All right, so you, just tell me what that does. You fire up into the air and you just do minimal damage, but all you know is that you clip one of their wings as they're swarming around, and what is it, just something comes out of the arrow, or?
They must succeed on a strength saving throw or be restrained.
How many?
Magical.
Anyone in a radius?
Nope.
Who does it affect?
Just the one that's hit.
Oh, doesn't hit anyone else? Okay. All right, so the arrow just disappears into the swarm, and you don't know what the effect of it is. It doesn't seem like anything is happening at the moment, but it's pretty far up in the sky. It's just kind of like specks right now, and they're starting to move like in a circle. They're swarming around, and now they're forming into a funnel, and they're starting to drop down. You don't know how many there are, but there's a lot of them. So why don't you go ahead, and so you're going to cast your spell. Where are you casting? The ship is moving towards that... towards the large overhead gate, and it's slowly coming down. But they're not sure if they're going to make it. They are trying. I'm going to make a roll for them, but we'll see what happens.
Okay, it's a 20-foot radius sphere, so I guess that would be like an arc over us.
You're about a minute from that gate. Do you want to cast it right now? Do you want to cast it later? Do you want to cast it right on you? Do you want to cast it in front of you? Like, what? Tell me exactly what you're trying to do with the spell, because there's a lot of things you could effectively do with it.
Now you're making me second guess my judgment. There's a lot of effective things. Because
it won't move with you unless you cast it on the ship itself.
Yeah, I want to cast it like above the ship, so as it moves.
So like on the mast or something
like that? Yeah, over the mast, yeah, because it can surround like around corners and it's a whole area.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But if you cast it like just in the air, it'll
stay
there.
But
if you cast it on a spot on the ship, it'll stay on the ship. You know what I'm saying?
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, I can just cast in the air.
You could cast in there if you wanted to, yes.
Yeah, you could, but it will stay
but
there
stay
as
there.
We move, so it'll be
so it'll stay there. Exactly. So I want it on the ship so that they can't like project where we're going.
How far are we
on
from
the ship?
How far are we from the door in terms of distance?
You guys are about a minute, so like 200 feet.
Okay,
dang it. Do you have entangle?
No. I have so much torgy though.
Okay.
So if we're like within 30 feet, I can cause the door to open because it's not locked. So I can make it open because it's closing right now.
It's pretty heavy. That's only a small amount, but you can do things with thaumaturgy like throw your voice, make sound, ghost sounds, that kind of stuff with it, I believe.
Ooh, yeah. That's I can like make it super loud, 3 times louder. Maybe I can hurt them, like so they fly away.
Or make us sound like we're kind of beside us. Like, so they dive beside us and someone could cast maybe Entangle or something, so they all go into it.
You have Entangle, don't you?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. So,
yeah, but you're on water.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you can't. You have
is there
to
another spell that they can all fly into?
All right, so they start to swarm around, and you cast it on the ship?
Yes.
On the top of the mast?
Yeah.
Okay.
Over top.
So it completely envelops the entire ship, and the fog kind of waves in and around. And so you can kind of see, if you're from an aerial point of view, you can see that there is a... there's this moving fog. They can see that, but they're not exactly sure where the ship would be in there. They have probably a good guess, but it's obscured. And you guys start to sail towards it. This crew is going to make a roll.
Come on, Captain.
Door.
I just want to show everyone at home what that was. Oh, I got to turn it this way. All right. Just so you know.
I
want to
know what that was.
What did you roll?
So the ship starts sailing towards it, and the birds are flying straight down. What did you want to... You can hear there's like this cacophony of sound as these birds start to get closer, and you can hear the flapping of feathers, and you can't see them because there's a canopy of fog all around you. You're completely surrounded in fog, but you can hear the cawing of birds as they start to get closer. What do you want to do as the ship gets towards that gate that's slowly lowering? And the ship, you guys can't tell because of the fog, but the captain... is like steering with the wheel and his back is to you. He looks like he's like bracing himself.
I'm gonna do a minor illusion cantrip and try to throw voices like far away from us in the fog as possible to try to make our ship sound like it's in a different location.
So who's doing that?
That's me. I have a minor illusion cantrip.
What is it?
It's just minor illusion cantrip.
So you're going to try to make it sound... Okay.
5 foot cube. So it's very faint voices. It's far away.
How far away can you do it?
Range is 30 foot range.
Okay. All right, so you... What do you say?
I'm just going to try to make it sound like our voices going, oh no, they're coming closer. Oh,
or like 30 feet or just like the edge of the fog? Where do you want to...
Yeah, the edge of the fog.
Okay.
They're coming closer. Oh no, hurry up. That kind of stuff.
All right. So you can hear the birds as they, all of a sudden they start to pierce through the fog and the ship gets, starts to go through the gate and it's coming down. And the captain just yells, brace! And you hear a huge splash as all of these birds hit straight into the water. It looks like they change at the last second to drop down as gnolls, but they are about 20 feet outside because they were tricked by the voice. And they all start falling into the water. A couple of them hit the side of the boat and like crash down and then flip and then roll onto the into the water. And the ship starts to go through, and the gate comes down and completely smashes the top of the mast off. And it starts to come straight down onto the main part of the boat. You guys can all make a dexterity saving throw. Oh, this is where you get advantage.
Yes, I do get advantage on dexterity saving throws.
21. Ooh.
Dex? Oh, boy.
So did, is that with your advantage? Did you roll two ones?
Oh, no. She doesn't get advantage.
No, I don't have an advantage. I just rolled a one.
Only she does because she has danger sense.
So that means I got 3 in total.
I got 21.
Okay. You both got 21?
I got 17. So even with my advantage, I didn't get great.
Well, I was too busy casting the spell.
So you're the only one that failed?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh. I wish you got this advantage.
It's okay. Into a tiger and swim my way out of this.
So you, at the last second, as everyone else dives out of the way, you look up and you try to go and it hits your shoulder and you hear a crack and you take 8 points of damage, but you fall to the ground and roll a little bit and the mast hits and splinters all along the deck and the ship kind of shakes a little bit as it does, but it manages to get through the gate, keeps coming down and shears off the back end. But not all the way down to basically mess up the structure of the boat. You manage to push through. And a bunch of the ravens are still coming through. But that fog, as that thing comes down, it starts to shift and fall. And hits the boat and then starts to fall into the water. And they all have to make reflex saves or they're going to go into the water as well. So a couple of them go straight into the water. You can hear the splashing as more of them hit. And 3 of them come straight up, and they go on top of the rampart where that gate is, and the large black raven swoops up on top of the rampart as well. And you can see they kind of disappear as the ship sails out slowly past the harbor out into the ocean. And you guys can all make perception checks.
19. 21.
Perception. Wait, insight?
Perception.
Perception.
Oh, nice. I got 18.
9.
Okay, if you got 15 or higher, you can see as you come through the other side and you as you get distance on the rampart, the wall where the gate is, you can see perched there 3 gnolls. Those are the 3 that flew up. And then the large raven changes about 5 feet from the air and lands on the ground and then just stands there and watches as the boat goes out of the harbor and continues on into the ocean. You can see it's Maven Vela and she just watches you go. She doesn't pursue. So the captain comes down from the where he's, you know, guiding his crew. And he goes over and he looks like he's talking to Whitford. They're having a quiet conversation in the corner. The sailors are busying themselves trying to move that mast. It's destroyed. It's going to have to be repaired. And that's what it looks like the captain might be talking to him about. He's a little upset about what's happened. But they're seeming to be having a conversation in the corner while the 4 of you are still standing on deck.
Yeah.
that's very strange. The Maven Bella just stopped pursuing us.
I know.
But she can fly.
Yeah, she can do whatever she wants. Like,
do you think this was part of her plan?
I don't know. It seems like maybe it's just supposed to seem threatening. But she could have easily attacked us here and now.
I still think that she's being controlled. And she's not acting under her own will completely.
So do you think her powers can only be within the city walls? Because if they're not her own, then there's only an area perhaps that she can be operated under?
Or maybe there's really someone bigger operating things out here. And that's kind of the end to. Of her jurisdiction.
I wish Olive was here so we could ask her.
Well, I did tell her to meet us in High Moon. So hopefully she got the message.
Hopefully that's still where we're heading.
Yeah.
Alright, so you guys continue to have a conversation. And eventually Whitford comes over to the four of you and he just looks a little distraught. Alright, well, so I've been informed by Blythe what has happened, and it seems that you have some other parties interested in your capture. Now, I don't care one way or another who you are. I'm not here to help you. I'm here to deliver these two women to justice. So I'm not going to be protecting you other than I need to deliver you. Whatever it is you've gotten yourself into is no business of mine. We'll take you to High Moon, but that's it. And he says, we're on our way to Sembia. We're going to stop in the city of Selgunt, where we will take a wagon to High Moon. But we have about a week ahead of us, and the captain has just informed me that it's going to take a little bit longer now, so it'll be a little bit longer than a week because of the destroyed mast. They are either going to have to stop for repairs, which I'm going to have to pay for. Thank you very much. This has all just gone to shit.
That's what I've been saying a lot lately.
So he turns around and starts to walk away, and Blythe walks up to you right afterwards, and she's like, I want you guys to know, I overheard what the captain was saying. I think they're going to try to make a stop at Red Rock to get this ship repaired before we head on to Selgunt. Put this up here. Yes, Selgunt. And she looks a little bit worried when she says that.
You seem concerned.
Well, yeah, no one really wants to go to Red Rock. That's pirate territory. But, yeah, I mean, it's the shortest route on the way to Selgunt, so I think that's where they're going to go. Maybe they have connections there, I don't know. Whitford is not happy about it.
What exactly needs repairing?
The mast. And you can see, like, just shorn off the top. We're not going to be able to go very far without... I mean, they're going to have to be doing a lot of rowing. And until then, it's just going to be a slow trip. Probably going to be on the sea for 3 days before we can even get this ship fixed. We can't go back to that harbor, obviously.
Yep. Definitely not.
No.
I have a cantrip for mending. But it says a single break.
Yeah. This ship is severely damaged. It wouldn't work in this case. Plus, they'd have to be able to get people to hold that. You would actually need a rigging. Mm-hmm. Like, you would need to get into a harbor to fix it. Right. Yeah.
We have a good rope.
You do have a good rope.
Yeah. A rope and an axe. I don't think pirates are that bad. They're kind of fun. I like pirates.
Have you met pirates?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. But I can't speak their language. I'm not very good at it. They have this, like, can't speak. I don't know. But otherwise, they're fun. They drink a lot of beer.
That sounds fun.
Rum. They drink a lot of rum.
So you've been through Red Rock before. it's part of what's called the Pirate Isles. There's a whole bunch of little small islands that that pirates do operate out of. But it is a little bit, it's not as bad as it used to be. You probably haven't been there for a few years, but you have traveled through there in your journeys. And so you know a little bit about that area. You have a bit of history there. You're not excited to go there.
I don't think it's such a great idea that we go there. I've been there, and it's not a great area, and it's not that safe. I wouldn't want to take you guys there.
Blythe says, we don't have a choice. We got to get this ship fixed. It's either that or we have to go back to the harbor. We can go to one of the smaller towns along the way, but there's no guarantee they'll even have the tradesmen who can do the job. There are a lot of just small fishing villages, but we know that there is a proper harbor in Red Rock.
I'm not that concerned. I mean, unless they're furry, then furry pirates were not so much fun. But otherwise, how bad could they be?
We'll just make it quick then, right?
Yeah.
Whoever
hopefully, yeah.
Whoever has to leave the boat has to leave to make it happen. But otherwise, we should just stay in one area.
Yes.
Yeah.
I agree.
You guys saved our asses back there, so if we do have to stop at Red Rock, then we'll make sure to watch out for you guys too.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So she just wanders away. You guys have about 3 days now, so you will get all your wounds back, you'll heal up, you can get your spells ready and stuff like that. But you have 3 days that you have to kill. What do you want to do in that time? We did leave a few things last session, the reveal about you being a criminal of some kind, Van, was a discussion that you had had for later. Whether or not you want to have that conversation is up to you, but there were a few things left in the air. Leah also, obviously, being a criminal in the past, was a surprise to Petunia. But you have 3 days. If you guys want to do some character work, go for it. I'm going to switch the camera.
Okay. I'm going to mostly sit off by myself. Don't really plan to discuss anything, but no, like, as a character, wouldn't be something I really want to, like, bring up, so I'm just off on my own.
Okay, so Leah keeps to herself over the course. So the first day is kind of, you know, they leave you to your own devices, the bounty hunters. They're as stuck as you are, so they just let you wander about the ship. There's nowhere you can really go. So Leah keeps to herself. What are the rest of you?
I guess I'm following... First, I'm following Rin around. And just, like, won't leave her alone. Just all following her around. Like, googling her, looking at everything she does.
All right.
I just think she's... I'm like,
ooh,
what
are you doing? So I can reply that in a second. And what are you guys, what are you two doing?
Normally, if the mast was there, I'd probably sit up at the highest point.
Yeah, but it's not.
But it's not. So the second best option is sitting up at the front of the boat.
Yeah.
Just kind of looking at the open ocean and the horizon and just meditating.
Okay.
I'm going to, at first I was kind of avoiding to have this conversation, but I'm going to approach Triella and walk slowly towards her.
All right. So you see her sitting up at the front of the boat, and she's quietly, and you can see that just from her body language she's like kind of in a meditative trance right now. And you know, you pass a couple sailors who are currently like doing the best they can to repair the damage of what happened on the ship. This is a couple hours into your trip. And, you see her by, and finally, like, they kind of clear away, and it's just the two of you at the front.
And I clear my throat.
Hello, man.
Hi. I wanted to talk to you and apologize for not talking to you before about this.
Were you ever going to tell me?
Of course. Yeah, absolutely. It was in the plan the whole time, but I just didn't want you to see a really bad part of me that it's in the past already. You need to know it's in the past.
Okay.
Do you trust me?
Yeah, I do trust you. It's just been really hard just because this one trip, like, I've been finding out all these secrets about you. You know? Like, I know that scout's pipe that you have. I know you just didn't find it.
Well, I hate to say this, but old habits die hard, you know? But that doesn't mean that I'm not renewed, and also, it just, you know, it wasn't really that I was just stealing to steal. It actually had a good purpose, like...
How?
I meant to help my family, because we got a big theft, and I was just trying to get back to my family, because we needed stuff, and... Also, it wasn't really to someone that we would hurt or anything. It was always people with a lot of money and kind of like Robin Hood style, you know, help the poor.
So who are you to make that judgment, Van? Two rights don't make a wrong. I mean, I don't know because I wasn't there, but it's just a lot to take on when I'm just hearing this all for the first time. That's a big part of you that I don't know.
I know. But we... just met very recently, like, I think this happened in the worst way, but at least now you know, and we know each other better now, and I am renewed.
Okay, well, I don't know what to say, because you say, like, I'm changed, this won't happen again, and then you just said, like, old habits die hard.
Well, like, meaning, because, yeah, well... But I'm really renewed. Like, not maybe not absolutely, like, 300% this new me, but I'm still changing little by little, and I shouldn't have taken that pipe.
Okay. Can we have no more secrets?
That sounds good to me. And, yeah, like, I actually... meant to ask you, what's with that recovery stuff that you had drop problems? See?
Okay.
This thing's just... I'm not the only one with secrets.
You're right. That's my past. Okay. Touché. So... from now on, we'll just work on things together, okay?
That sounds great.
Because we work better as a team.
No more secrets.
Okay. Thanks, honey.
Thank you.
All right, so the two of you have a quiet conversation. How do things kind of paint the scene for me as that scene ends? What are you guys doing?
I'm holding her hand now.
Okay. So the two of you are at the front, and meanwhile, we have Petunia. You were talking to...
I was like, oh, God, that's tight. No, she's kidding.
All right, so, Petunia, you are talking with Rin. Well, you're following her around.
I'm just following her around. That's weird. Camera right in
front of me. You're following Rin around, and she... she seems like she's very quiet. She notices and looks back every once in a while, sees you're following her, and she gives you a bit of a half smile, but then she'll turn around and walk in the other direction, and you just keep following her around?
I'll just, like, look at some of the, just whatever she's doing, and then... No, I'm not going to engage her in conversation.
Yeah.
I'm actually going to just kind of watch everything. Like, I'm really, really interested. And then kind of be like, I get a little bored. And then and then wander off and go sit beside Leah.
Okay, so the two of you finally sit next to each other, and they have had their conversation. What do you do when you sit down next to Leah?
Do you think that we can make a fishing rod? And catch the fish.
Yeah, I don't see why not. They might even have fishing rods on the boat already.
Oh. I like rot. You know, you leave it out to rot for a long time, and you leave it for like 2 days in the sun. It tastes, it's the best.
I'm going to just trust your judgment on that one. And not try that by myself.
That's good.
I'm just going to, like, reach over and kind of, like, knock your hat a little bit and kind of nudge you.
So, why you decide to go to jail?
Oh, decided it would be better to just go along with it. You know, I don't want to go to jail or wherever we're going.
Then why are you going? It. Then don't go.
Because it's the right thing to do.
Well, you just... I know you had problems, but is it because people just don't like you that you have to go?
I hope people like me. No,
I'm... Some people don't like me.
So you have to go to jail because nobody likes you.
Wow, nobody liked me in my hometown. So aww. I could see them sending me to jail. But I left anyway.
No, you didn't do anything like what we did, but no, the reason that I'm going along with this is because if I fight back, I'm just putting you guys in danger.
I can handle it. You could leave, fight. Well, maybe not Rin. We could run.
Could run, but we're running already from a lot of people, and to be honest, taking this trip here is probably the safest way that we can run.
That's true. I wonder if they can lock you downstairs at night.
Do you have a problem, Petunia?
Yeah.
What's up? What's on your mind?
Well, I don't know if you remember, but you tried to eat Shriella, and then Van tried to eat me, and then you guys were really... You turned into monsters.
Yeah. No, I definitely... Well, I mostly remember.
So, wouldn't you feel better if you were behind a locked door at night in the moon? So, maybe...
Maybe I would.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Then maybe... But you could maybe eat the guards and then you'd be free. Unless you really want to go back to jail. I don't know.
Well, at this point, considering you're clearly terrified of me, then...
I don't get scared. I'm just saying, you know, safety-wise.
Well, I don't know. I'm doing all this because I don't want you guys to get hurt. Maybe it would be better to just... Let them lock us up.
Whoa. Well, no. You know what? We're gonna find a cure. We're gonna get to the end of this. We're gonna get the bowl and break the bowl or drink out of the bowl or throw the bowl. Oh no, we shouldn't throw it in the ocean. No.
That's bad. Worst idea ever.
We're bad. It's like the gremlins at the pool. Just don't put it in the water. We'll figure it out. We'll get to the end of it. You're my friend. And Van and Shriella are my friends too. And I haven't had friends. So, like, good friends. That last for a long time. So, I'm gonna figure it out. We'll figure it out. Even if we do go to jail, I'll come in. I will figure it out.
Yeah. No, I hope we do. I don't want to leave you guys, but if that's what needs to be done to make sure you guys stay safe, then that's what we'll do. If we can find some way out of this, then we'll do that too.
Yeah.
All right, so you guys have a quick conversation. Later at night, so you guys have quarters in this ship, in below deck. And you two are kept in a separate room together. You guys are, there is a cell down there, and Van and Leah are kept there. And you guys are, you don't really have quarters. You more have like an area where they would have their cargo that they have given you a place to lay down with a bedroll. But that's it, because you weren't really supposed to be on this trip.
Yeah.
And in the middle of the night... You guys are asleep, or you're trancing, or you're sleeping, and you would be doing the same. You see Whitford walks down, and he comes to the bars, and he goes into his pocket, and he pulls out the ring. And he's turning it around in his hands, and he just kind of, psst! Van.
Yes, sir.
come over here. And he's turning the ring in his hand. So he gets close when you get to the bars, and he's just holding the ring out. Now, I want you to tell me about this ring. What do you know about it?
Why are you so curious about it?
I'm a wizard. I find any of these items curious. It's my nature.
Well, it's just a trinket that we got in a battle, and I like to keep them as treasures.
Where did you find it?
We found it on...
Oh, that area?
In the Grey Forest.
Right? Found it in the Grey Forest, and I would appreciate if you give it back to me. I ask you very kindly.
So,
good boy.
Are you casting a spell on it? Is that
no.
He's like going. Like,
I. No, not yet.
So he.
Persuasion.
He drops it back in his pocket and pats it, and he leans. He goes, steps back and crosses his arms. Well. This is a ring of Malar. I suppose it's possible that you just came across the item. But I don't think it's that possible. Since I know about the association that your wife and your friend Petunia have with the kindred spirits, and from what I know of what Blythe has told me about what happened with the Minister of Religion, there's something up with that. Why do you need this ring exactly?
Can I roll, would it be perception?
Intuition, if you're trying to get a feel for him.
Yeah, like
yeah.
Intuition. I want to see if I can kind of trust him.
Like insight.
Yeah, insight, yeah.
Yay, Ben remembered insight.
Yeah, we never remember.
Rest of us
remember.
Never
remember.
Hey, I remembered last time.
Yeah. Oh,
it was
just us.
15.
He seems to have just a genuine curiosity about it. But there's something more going on here that he's not revealing to you. He steps a little bit closer again, and he's you know, squinting his eyes a bit, and he's looking at you closer. You're cursed with lycanthropy, aren't you?
Why do you say that?
You were bitten, right? I'm trying to remember.
Yeah.
You were
here.
Yeah.
It
was me.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You're here. Yeah.
So he just points.
Yeah. I got bitten.
What does the ring do for you? Have you been able to understand how it works? How to attune it?
I don't really know how it works. Do you know how it works?
Yes. These are very rare and very valuable. But a part of me wants to keep it for further study. But a part of me is also a little bit concerned that I could be on a boat full of shape changers.
Well.
Who else is cursed with this?
Jeez, I know.
I would recommend for your safety that you give me that ring. I am cursed with it, and I think it could help me not attack you.
Make a persuasion check. It's gonna be a tough one.
Oh, get it back!
Ah! Oh, but you got some more.
This is what I did. 16.
He just smiles. I don't think so. For all I know,
darn wizards.
For all I know, it could make you much more powerful, and I can't risk that right now. What about your friend there? And points to Leah, who's in a trance right now. Is she also cursed? I'm willing to bet that she is.
I think she's alright. At least she hasn't mentioned anything to me.
Deception check.
She's the one. Oh, damn it. 16?
I won like 20.
She needs to do.
Yeah.
I suppose you, if anyone, would know if they were. Yeah. Very well. Oh. Your wife?
Oh, no.
The small one?
She's perfectly fine.
No, that's... I will keep this ring in my possession, and I will think about what to do with it. In the meantime, I would appreciate any heads up if you feel the need to change. I talked to the captain already. My assumptions about your condition now have proven true. We don't have a full moon for at least another 2 weeks. Still, you'll be remaining in this cage until we return to Selgund. And he turns and he starts to walk away. What do you want to say?
I want to whistle. Never, no. Dang it.
What to do? What do you want to do?
I want to whistle the song, the harpy song.
Misha's song?
And see, yeah.
Okay, so you're going to sing, you're going to whistle it or sing it?
Whistle it.
Okay. So you start to whistle the tune, and as soon as you start doing it, you know that there's not enough power behind it to make it magical.
Mm-hmm.
You would have to sing it. Okay. But he stops, and he looks back at you, but he doesn't say anything, and he keeps on going. Mm. All right. Is there anything you guys want to do over the course of the next few days?
So they have to stay... in their, like, their cell now. For the
I
whole
think
time?
Just me, no?
Yeah, they put you, they've put them down there permanently.
Till
at Whitford,
arrive.
You don't know why.
Yeah.
Whitford has basically said they will be remaining in their cell until we deliver them. We are going to have our repairs done at Red Rock. And once we return to Selgund, they will be taken out and we'll be traveling on foot. But that has changed because earlier... they were allowed to walk around.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to look for Blythe.
All right. So Blythe is... she's keeping herself busy. Looks like she's reading books. She's got a backpack full of them. She's obviously gone into her room. Actually, she's in her room right now, and you know where she's staying. The door is closed, so we'll start there.
Okay. So I knock on the door politely.
So... the door opens up, and again, like I said, you see there's a pile of books, and she's got one under her arm that she's reading. It looks like a some kind of report on the ecological effect of goblins in the northwestern reaches, and she's just kind of reading about them and finding them interesting, I guess, and she just looks at you. Yeah, what's up?
I don't mean to interrupt your evening read. I just...
oh, I've read this one 5 times. It's okay.
Oh, okay, good. I just had a question for you. We made you a promise that we'd protect you when you guys went to Red Rock, but half of our party's locked up now, and I don't know why that's changed.
Yeah, Whitford made the decision this morning. He informed the rest of the team that that would be the case. Apparently, your party has also been keeping more secrets, something about being shape changers. Of the lycanthropy kind. And Whitford's a little concerned that they might be able to change at will and be able to break free and are a danger to people, so he's just going to be keeping him in there. I'm sure you understand.
Oh. And this all just came from Whitford?
I believe so.
How do you feel about it?
I mean, if they have that ability... I would feel much more happy that they're behind bars, yes? No offense, but, we've already seen what the minister could do. If you are even half as powerful, then it's best that they're behind bars. But we will deliver you safely, that is our job, and we will do it.
I just ask because you know us. You and Rin know us best because you were with us. So, if you feel okay about it, then this is your ship and this is your protocol, so...
I trust Whitford. Whitford's an old crotchety asshole, but he's a smart man, and I listen to what he has to say.
Okay, but if you lock them up and something happens, they can't help you. Just know that.
I guess we'll see when the time comes.
Thank you.
So she closes the door and goes back about her business. So the 3 days pass, and eventually, whoever's not locked away in a cell, you guys have been. You've been fed, you've been given water. You were able to have guests, and so you guys can see each other and speak to each other. But it's mostly just kind of long hours of the day. And eventually, on the morning of the third day, you can see in the distance all these misty mountain kind of like islands rising up out of the water in the distance. And you can see there's a few of them pretty far away, but the most central one, which is directly ahead, is actually a large red colored mountain in the distance. And you can hear the captain call out, "Red Rock!" And all the sailors come on deck and they start preparing, and a lot of them have been rowing for days. They're exhausted, they're famished, they are looking forward to having a mast and a sail again, and the ship starts to pull into the harbor. You guys can all make perception checks if you are above deck.
Not you two.
I just hear perception.
Sorry, my life. She's like, woohoo! darn, 12.
a 10.
Okay. So you guys are on deck and just seeing this beautiful coastal island, and it's just, as you start to get closer, you can see that there is another ship harbored on the docks. It's a smaller harbor, but this is a place that you can already see it's a much more sophisticated, just like the one that you left behind. This isn't like a fishing village or anything like that. This is a major port. And it's just lush jungle all the way up where that red mountain just kind of peaks out. And it's just like this crimson dark red. It's absolutely beautiful against the deep lush green and the mist that rises up out of the town. And it's just a small town. It's a small town of Red Rock. And they start to pull into the harbor, and you guys don't really see anything out of the ordinary. But as the
should have rolled higher.
As the ship starts to pull into the second dock, there's four available docks, and they pull into the one next to the other ship that's already there. Now that you're close enough, you can see that the other ship, which is on the left-hand side of you, its flags and its mast are all closed in, so they're not out and open. Obviously, that's what they do when they come into port. They would put that all away. But there's nobody on the ship right now. And as you start to get closer, even though you can't see anything, there's something weird about the fact that there's nobody at the dock to greet you. This is a major port. There would be people there right away. Whether it be people who actually work on the docks or people that are there immediately to sell you shit. There's no life on this immediate dock vicinity. It's really, really quiet. And the captain steps down and he starts whispering to the sailors that are working for him. He can't really make out what he's saying as you do. You guys can make perception checks, just the two of you. You guys can make perception checks because a sailor comes down the stairs and starts talking to someone who's currently getting a bunch of stuff ready to come into harbor.
That's a one.
Jeez.
17.
I rolled a
22.
I got 8.
So you kind of are listening in, and the captain is like, "Something's up. Red Rock, I don't think is safe. Keep your eyes open. I think we might be walking into a trap." And what did you guys get?
16.
6.
So one of the sailors is like, "Captain thinks something's up. Everyone on deck." And they all. So now you guys are aware something weird is going on. You can't see anything from where you are. The ship stops away a little bit away from the dock, and the captain goes out on deck, and he's looking around, and he slowly motions for them to slowly bring it in. And all of the sailors are getting on the one side of the ship where you would go down the ramp towards the actual dock itself. And they're watching. Everyone is watching. But you still don't see anything. You don't see anything out of the ordinary. The captain lowers the plank and motions for two people. And you've noticed in the 3 days, even you guys down below deck, that he's got two people that are kind of his right hand. They're two women in their probably mid-20s. They're human. And they're pretty, like, rough-looking sailor women. They're missing a few teeth. They've got, like, tattoos, sleeves all the way down both sides.
So they hang out at the docks.
They definitely hang out at the docks. And they pop down, and they start going up to the dock, just the two of them, and they are disappearing up into the town. And the captain just turns to you and says, All right, well, we are a little concerned. This is usually a very busy port, and we don't see any market stalls out. We don't see anybody around. This is a little bit weird, and we are just sending two people in to take a look, quick scout around, and we'll see what happens. But just remain on board, please, until we investigate the matter further.
Is there a fog around, you said, too? A mist, or is it just
there's a that, it's just a natural mist that goes up from the jungle. Yeah.
Petunia.
You should have told them to be careful of rats and birds and anything moving.
This is a port town. There's going to be lots of those in droves. Okay. Rats and birds.
That's not like how you know them.
Well, if the ones that I saw attacking are any indication, do you think that's going to be a problem here in the middle of nowhere?
Could be.
There's nobody here. That's unusual. Isn't this a pirate hangout?
So he motions for a few more sailors, and he whispers to them, go join them. And they go off as well, so five more go into town.
Don't get bit by anything.
And they disappear further into town. You can see that it's like the large docks lead up to, there's a very large two-story building. That is the harbor master's, so ships would be logged in there. This isn't actually like a pirate island. It used to be, but it's been legitimized as like an actual port that is safe from pirates, theoretically. And but it's a large two-story building that overlooks the entire harbor. And so they are walking towards it and moving into an alley and behind that building while you guys are all watching from the deck. You guys can make perception checks now that you're aware something is going on, but nobody has come down to tell you anything. You guys are still... No, you're still down below deck.
I think it's probably 15.
First session. I got 20.
So, you are just watching. This is really strange. And you catch a glimpse. You're looking at that building. It's a two-story building with a large thatched roof. And it's angled. And you spot a head about this high just popping up and peering and then pops back down again.
Could I see what it... Just a head. I don't know if it was a human or...
It's a human. It's a human head, yeah.
Petunia, there's someone in that building.
Oh.
Right on top of the roof.
They're on
top. They're looking down over top of it.
I wish we took our seagull. That seagull that I could send, but we sent him.
That was 3 days ago.
You know what?
Yeah, I know. I'm like,
I should have made another seagull friend. Oh, well.
There are lots around here. This is a port town.
Oh, maybe I'll do that.
There's like hundreds just flying around.
Okay. I thought you meant there was like nothing.
No, there's just no people. It's really quiet.
I'm going to try to call over another seagull. And I'm going to ready my ritual.
So you start doing this, trying to get it, and Rin comes over and just kind of grabs your hand. Not now, please. Enough with the birds.
No, Rin, we saw someone.
Where?
At the thatched roof, the top.
So she takes turns and takes a look. Oh, shit. Yeah, you're right, there is someone up there.
That's weird. It's gonna be a trap. They're watching us.
Oh, it's definitely a trap.
Yeah.
So you can see them, the people getting close to the building. And that is when that person pops out, just comes up, and the sailors are moving right behind. The two women have already made it into the alley. And the five sailors are just kind of crouched down and moving about 40 feet behind. Pops out and shoots a crossbow bolt, hits him right in the throat, and he hits the ground clutching and and just blood starts spilling out all over the cobbled road that leads up to that building. And all of a sudden you see people start pouring out behind buildings en masse.